Let's start today. It's April 11th, I think. It is. I'm in the warmest apartment of all of Europe, and this is the product update. And the first thing I would like to mention, normally I talk about like future versions and all big things, but after we released 9.0, we removed the left sidebar, and people said, that's such a big shame, because I lost the ability to quickly see how many issues are assigned to me and how many pull requests are assigned to me. And we actually shipped this in a patch change, and I'm very proud of the team. They moved really fast after having heard the criticisms about the sidebar and having lost this functionality. They came up with something new, and we treated it like a regression, and we shipped it in a patch release. And I'm very proud, and it's a very nice change, and I love the colors. Also, if there's zero, there's no color there, so it doesn't stick out too much. It's just great. So congratulations to everyone that was involved with that. I also want to update on the technical writing team. They are also part of product nowadays, and they do a lot of interesting things. So I want to highlight some of the things that they recently did. They added topics to the top of GitLab Docs. So if you go to GitLab Docs, there's topics there. And it really nicely puts together some information on topics that otherwise is distributed all throughout the documentation. For instance, you want to know about GitLab Pages, there's a really nice one for that there. And you'll find the installation, the setup, the maintenance, but also how to use it. And it's just linked to other parts of the documentation. So we still maintain a single source of truth, but it makes it easier to find these things. Sean is working on a website, Conversational Development, about, well, exactly what it is called. I recommend you check it out. We're adding a whole bunch of comparisons to the comparison page. We just added Jenkins, but there's a few coming up shortly. The index pages of documentation are being improved and updated, so it's easier to scroll through things. And the topics are actually good examples of this. And what we're finally doing is removing the table of contents that is now on top of the documentation to the sidebar, at least if your screen is wide enough. And you wouldn't believe how big of a difference this makes. The documentation can look very overwhelming with a huge list on top, and now that will change. So much for technical writing. Good news is 9.1 is already done. On the 7th, we closed the milestone and we started work on the next one. So we know actually exactly what's going to ship in 9.1. And one of the major things is Service Desk. And what Service Desk is, it is customer support straight from GitLab. And I wanted to explain a little bit more in detail how that exactly works. The idea is that if you have a customer, or not a customer, potential customer, or someone that wants to share something with you that is related to your service, or they can email a regular email address. So in GitLab, there's an email address. You can, for instance, forward that from a specific one, or you can just share that one. And customers can directly email to that email address and get email back from whoever's on the other side. Because what happens on the other side is that inside of GitLab, a confidential issue will be created. And everyone that is active on that issue, all the responses there, they will be automatically emailed back. So this is a very powerful way to have feedback, to have customer support, or anything else that has some sort of interaction inside of GitLab without requiring people to sign up to your instance. It's a very, very powerful idea. It's very simple, and it makes use of so many of the existing GitLab features that made it very easy to work on this. We have many plans for the future. For instance, you know, what is glaringly missing right now is a really simple email address, but because we are building on older infrastructure, we couldn't do that. It all comes in the future, but this, as it says right here, works, and I think it's just beautiful. It just lowers the threshold to contribution, to having people share something with you in your issue tracker to the lowest possible way. Very cool. Other very cool thing is Canary Deploy. So Canary comes from the canary that they used in the coal mines for, you know, when the methane gas or the carbon monoxide was too high, the canary would die, and then you knew you had to get out, because as a human, you can withstand a little bit more of that, but not much more. And a canary deploy basically does that. You do a single deploy or to one or a few containers instead of to your whole cluster. If they pass, if they work, okay, then you can decide to deploy the rest. But if they fail, then you have the option to just roll those back, and not everyone is affected. Only a subset of your users' raises can be effective. Very useful. Another one, burn down charts. Burnout charts is best shown. This is what it looks like. It gives you an idea of how far along you are in a particular milestone. So if I have 100 issues and I have 100 days, it means that on average, I have to close one issue a day in order to complete the milestone. And a burnout chart will give you exactly that. It will show you the line that you see here, the straight linear line that says this is approximately how you should do it. And it gives you the actual line of where you are and where you've been. It's a much requested feature, and it's very heavily used in agile teams. And this is an interesting one. So we made it easier to access templates. Imagine how, but it's not a big change, it's very minor, but the thing is, many of the magical powers of GitLab rely on templates. For instance, creating a Docker file or using auto-deploy, that's all based on templates. And up until recently, what you had to do is you had to type the file name before you get to show the template dropdown. Now that's a very elegant solution, but we want to encourage people, for instance, to create a GitLab CI file. And it's very easy to mistype when you type .gitlab-ci-yaml. Well, that's no longer the case. You can now just find the template in the dropdown and you can easily click it. So we hope this encourages people to create more CI YAMLs, create more gitignores, et cetera, this should make it easier for everyone. I also love this GIF. It's like so satisfactory to look at this. And there's a whole bunch of other cool improvements, and this is not even nearly all of it, but just to mention some of them, we now have recent searches in the issue search bar. So if you have very complex queries, you can just click them, choose local storage, so it's very, very fast. The merge request widget has been updated in 9.0, even more updates in 9.1. There's a mini pipeline graph in the commit view, so you can see exactly where your pipeline is. This is, to me, one of the coolest things ever. There's a mini Prometheus graph in a merge request widget, so you can see what the current state is, for instance, of memory. You can now restrict tag pushes. Before you could restrict to branches, now you can do the same to tags. One of those things that obviously we should have done it a long time ago, now it is in GitLab. And we can never stop mentioning this because it does require a lot of effort. There's many performance improvements in GitLab. We really make a very conscious effort to prioritize them. We prioritize them over other things. So it should be mentioned, and it's extremely important. The team has worked very hard to make GitLab faster in almost every way. So that's awesome. All right. If you can see the small letters here, it says 9.2. Which is our next release, which actually we've already started. So yesterday we had the kickoff, which is always the first work day after the 7th, where we say, okay, this is what we're going to do next. And what I forgot to include here, but I should share with you, is that we created the blog post already of GitLab 9.2. So you can already look at the blog post of what we're going to ship on May 22nd. I think that is a really cool idea by Sid. And it worked out. But I'm going to summarize some of the cool things here. One of the coolest things, and I was checking out the issue, and Mark has made it very humble, saying you can link between project pipeline views. But what this really is that this is cross-project pipelines, the ability to say, if this project's pipeline is done, then trigger this one, or this one is required for this one. Or what it actually means is that you can now have pipelines to span multiple projects. So if you have a project that has multiple dependencies, those dependencies can then trigger a rebuild of that project. And you can see that. And here's a screenshot. There's a lot of screenshots available in the issue. It's for Enterprise Edition Premium. And it's such a cool thing. This is the future, right? GitLab itself is like this. We have many different dependencies. They have to all work, come together. And once they're all together, we have to put it all together and test that. Now, we can now actually do that very visually, or we will be able to do that very visually within GitLab with native support for that. There's many additions and changes and requirements for us to fully implement cross-project pipelines, but this is a very good start. So I'm very, very excited about that. And I think once this is released, everyone will be very happy with it. Another one is, and it seems minor, but it's such a big change in the product, is that you can have multiple assignees for issues. And this will be an Enterprise Edition starter. It's just that. It sounds very, very simple. You can just assign multiple people, but it actually affects almost every single view in GitLab, right? So everywhere where you see this person is assigned, we have to now be able to say, these people have been assigned, and it can be, you know, it can be one person, it can be two, but it can also be 90. And we have to account for that. So very excited about that. We've been working it already for a while, so it will definitely ship. Very cool. Another one, and I can't really show you this because we're still working on the final UX for this iteration, and that is the related issues. So in GitLab, things are already automatically linked up, but sometimes you want to make a relationship explicit. And the very we're always looking for the smallest iteration, and in this case, the way we do it is you just explicitly announce these two issues are related, and it will be an Enterprise Edition starter. In the future, the intent is, of course, to be able to say the nature of a relationship, to say this issue blocks that issue, or this issue is blocked by that issue, or etc. You know, these kind of relationships. But there's a small starter, first iteration, we say, okay, you can formally say now whether issues are related. And it makes management of very complex and large issues somewhat easier. And then another one, and I think this is also so cool. So you can, right now, if you deploy your application from GitLab to Kubernetes, you get all these cool Prometheus metrics. So you see them in the environments page. You see like, oh, this is memory and this is performance. But what you really want, of course, is to have any kind of metrics. So with this change, it will allow you to have your own metrics that you configure in Prometheus appear inside of GitLab. So you could track whatever you want. It could be business metrics. It could be any kind of metrics coming from your application or your server, and they will be visualized in GitLab. Super cool. And then lastly, and this is a big one, we're starting to translate GitLab. Translating a large application with many, many different pages such as GitLab is a very, very intense, very complex process. So we're doing, as always, the smallest possible thing. We're taking the SQL analytics page and we're saying, okay, we're going to translate this, or at least prepare it for translation and maybe add one or two translations. That is what we're going to do this release. And then we are going to continue this work over many, many releases. And of course, hope that the open source community will help us with this. But this is a big stop, big start of this, and a very big deal, I would say, because you don't see this very often, that applications as big, as complex in the market as we are also translated. But I think it's very beautiful because it will allow everyone to use GitLab, you know, without too much problems. If you don't speak perfect English, you can still understand what pipelines actually are, because otherwise that word seems very strange, at least to me. And that's it. Let me know if there's any questions. I'll also check this chat. Stop sharing. Mark Bell says, is our support team using Service Desk now? They are not yet, but I know that Victor already created an issue for us to dog food Service Desk to start using it. But Service Desk is not live yet on GitLab.com. So, and because we all use GitLab.com, we have to wait for it to be live. So the 7th is passed, we're done with developing, but now we have to create the initial release candidates, do the testing, and then once a release candidate is live, we can start using Service Desk. All right, I'll give you 10 more seconds, or by my pure guessing of 10 seconds. I mean, this was a long presentation. You gotta have at least one question. Is Dutch the first language? It is my first language. I don't know if it will be the first language to translate to. I think that what we'll actually do is right now in GitLab, when you look at the page, most of the strings are hard-coded. So in the code, we actually say button or okay or merge. And what we have to do is we have to change that and reference it to an external file. And depending on your language setting, that file has to be English or German or Dutch. That will be the first step. So maybe the first language will be, actually for sure, it will be English. Maybe the second one will be Dutch, but it all depends on who's implementing it. Or Flemish. I'm Dutch, so I think grammatically they are the same. Spanish and German are the first two, says Mike. Ah, yeah, that makes sense. All right, your 10 seconds are way over. Thank you, everybody, for listening, and see you in the team call.